So far this year, the weather has been absolutely crazy. From monster tornadoes to historic floods and record-breaking cold and snow blasts, I, for one, am ready for a vacation. Unfortunately, things aren't looking to calm down anytime soon. We are on the brink of experiencing a super El Nino that will have the potential to cause more extreme weather through the rest of the year. In this video, I'm going to explain exactly what that means for you and how you can prepare for it. Every couple years or so, you'll hear about this El Nino Southern Oscillation, or ENSO for short, which basically refers to the temperature of the biggest body of water on Earth, the Pacific Ocean, specifically around the equator. We refer to periods of cooler than average waters in the Pacific as La Niña, and when things start getting warmer, we call that El Niño. For the past 3 years, we've been in a La Niña oscillation, which is quite unusual as a typical La Niña will only go on for about 9 to 12 months. And several months ago, the waters in the Pacific started to show signs of heating up, causing us to think we were probably headed into an extended period where the Pacific was somewhere between a La Niña and an El Niño, and we usually call that a neutral ENSO. But now, sea surface temperatures are already starting to rocket past what would be considered neutral, prompting the Climate Prediction Center to actually issue an El Niño watch for all of Earth. What this means is we've got a 90% chance of being in a full-blown El Niño by late fall, and it's very likely that temperatures are going to keep going up as we go into winter, and that could lead to a much stronger than usual El Niño, and some people call it a super El Niño. Now, I know a lot of you are probably wondering at this point, why do we care about how daggone hot the water is out here in the middle of nowhere? Well, once again, this is the biggest body of water on Earth, and the weather patterns down here have a ripple effect that ultimately affect everything in the atmosphere worldwide. You see, normally the winds near the equator blow pretty strongly from east to west. We call these the trade winds. And usually these trade winds will shove warm water and all the thunderstorms that they fuel away from South America, which allows the cold water from underneath the surface to rise up and suppress new thunderstorm growth in the middle of the Pacific Ocean for the most part. At least that's how it normally works. However, in situations like the one we're in, the trade winds actually start to let up and a huge heat dome builds up over the Pacific. This keeps all the warm water in a giant pile in the middle of the ocean, sparking off numerous big-time clusters of intense thunderstorms. This change in activity sets off a chain reaction that literally shifts the jet stream so much the weather is affected pretty much everywhere on Earth, even in your own backyard. And it's pretty obvious how El Niño can affect global weather and widespread patterns, but how can we determine how exactly it's going to affect smaller, more specific areas like your backyard? Well, the weather is complicated, and what happens on a day-to-day basis is influenced by much more than just the current phase of the ENSO, but El Niño is so impactful that there will be noticeable differences in the average kind of weather you see throughout the rest of this year. For example, down here in the southern U.S., things are going to get wetter than average all the way through winter. This is because the warming waters in the Pacific will literally shift the Pacific jet stream towards the U.S., leading to more storm systems training over this region. And during a regular El Niño, this can cause flooding and mudslides, especially down here in California. In fact, during the winter season of 1998, during one of the strongest El Niños ever recorded, an estimated $4 billion in damage was done and 190 lives were taken by major floods down here in Southern California. And remember, this upcoming oscillation could be abnormally strong or a super El Niño, so we have to watch these areas very carefully. In the northern U.S., things will likely be much drier than usual because the jet stream winds will be oriented in such a way that large storms will impact this area less often. This is also going to lead to much warmer than average temperatures, which can be expected as we go all the way into winter. Even this seemingly quieter kind of weather pattern change can have extreme implications, like droughts, where a lot of the more intense ones happened during an El Niño phase. These are all big problems, but El Niño can even affect smaller or more specific features of our weather, like tornado activity. Due to the way the Pacific jet stream will be hitting the U.S., there will be more recurring storm systems in and around the Gulf Coast and Florida. And because of this, we can actually expect an increase in tornadic activity down here as we go into winter. And probably one of the most interesting things about El Niño is how it impacts winter weather here in the States. Typically, the East Coast is going to be expected to be warmer and drier than usual, and that might lead you to believe that we're going to see less snow. And that very well could be true, but there's also a correlation between El Niño and strong East Coast blizzards. You see, due to the Pacific and polar jets being shifted so close to each other, they will sometimes interact in a way that actually causes moisture-induced polar phasing systems that bury parts of the U.S. in deep snow. And El Nino actually plays a huge role in our hurricane seasons here in the U.S. Remember how we talked about a giant heat dome and high pressure ridge that would likely form over the Pacific? Well, this is going to lead to a big bulge in the jet stream that's almost certainly going to cause a big trough on the eastern side of it. And this basically just means that strong winds and colder air aloft is going to dive into the tropics over the Atlantic Ocean. These strong winds will create wind shear, and hurricanes hate wind shear. And you're probably thinking, but Ryan, you're always talking about how wind shear actually creates severe thunderstorms and tornadoes. Shouldn't it intensify hurricanes too? And the answer to that is no. Unlike mothership supercells and wedge tornadoes, hurricanes are big babies. Everything has to be just right for them to thrive. Even the smallest thing, like a little bit of changing winds in the upper atmosphere, can literally tear them apart. El Nino has the tendency to create an environment that's not so good for babies, so it's less likely that tropical storms and waves will have the ability to grow into hurricanes as we go deeper into the season. So if a super El Nino is in our future as we head towards 2024, we can expect potentially disruptive warmth and dryness from the Pacific Northwest through the northern plains all the way into the Northeast. We can also expect a lot of potentially dangerous storms in Southern California to Florida, but the ones in Florida will more than likely be tornado related and not hurricane related. And then there's a whole lot of variability for all the areas in between. So what can we do to prepare for something as big and impactful as a super El Nino? The first step is to remember what I always say, don't be scared, be prepared. Just make sure you understand the potential impacts in your area and have some way of organizing the steps you need to take to mitigate the risks associated with whatever that may be. My gut tells me that's something that you're interested in since you've watched this whole video. And as always, I highly recommend having a good radar app for that. A real good one like Radar Omega. I've used Radar Omega for years and it's my personal go-to radar app. It's also what I use to guide millions of people through severe weather events during live streams. And I've talked about this before, but the latest update on this thing is absolutely nuts. The app is super snappy, responsive, and the user interface just keeps getting simpler and cleaner and easier to understand. This is a professional tool. You can have the exact same stuff the people at the National Weather Service have access to just by downloading an app. But they make it simple to use, and it's very easy to just access the simple Doppler radar we are all familiar with. The coolest thing about this app now is how fast it is at receiving warning information from the National Weather Service. It's faster than any other app, and you can actually get the new warning boxes to flash and send sound alerts as they occur. This is potentially a life-saving tool that I've been hooting and hollering about for years, since long before they ever sponsored the channel. I really do love the product. I think that you need it, and I think you're going to love it. So I've got links for you down there in the description if you want to go click them and get the app, iOS, Android, anything like that. It is a very useful tool, and once again, it's the one that I use. So thank you so much for watching. That's all the weather I have to talk about today. Make sure you slap that subscribe button, and also huge shout out to all of our members. And yeah, that's it. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next one. Goodbye. Ooh.